Okay, everyone, welcome. This is the West Shore Photography Club, June 19th, 2023 meeting. To start with, our next meeting will be July 10th. There's no meeting next week or the week after because it's the 4th of July weekend. The subject on the 10th will be Flash Photography 101 with Valerie Hoffman. Trip reports. Norbert, are you here? I see his name.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, can you give us an update on the trip to the Rolls-Royce Museum?
The Rolls-Royce, you say?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, we had, I think, 12, 15 people that showed up. And actually, I think it was a pretty good morning. We had a lot of opportunities there to do some very unique cars. And they were very forthcoming. They gave us carte blanche to the area. We could go into the garage area, so they were not restrictive at all. And anyway, if anyone has any photographs that were on this trip, if you would send to them, they would appreciate that. They always look for some neat photographs, and of course they would give you credit for the photograph also. So that's it on that.
Great. Fantastic. The other thing that happened was last Thursday, there was Dennis had a workshop on infrared photography. Is there anybody here who was there and would like to comment on it? Apparently nobody wants to talk about it. There was probably about 12 to 14 people there, which was a really good turnout. And he quickly went through the kind of how to get started in infrared photography and then set us loose to take pictures. It was very interesting and I enjoyed it a lot. Okay. Next thing is the upcoming trips. The first one, Norbert, it's back to you, the Steelton Skateboarding.
Yes, that's this Saturday at 10 o'clock in Steelton. And that's always a pretty interesting thing, too. I mean, it gives you a lot of opportunity to do a lot of panning photography and action photography with the skateboarders. And if it's a nice morning, I would suspect there might be a lot of skaters there. So it could be very interesting. So I got my fingers crossed it doesn't rain, and we have a lot of skaters in action. So they're pretty photogenic. They don't really mind about being photographed either. So one other thing, I think Dennis said in the blurb about it, knee pads might be a prerequisite here, because you do have to get down low and get these really neat shots. So that might be a good thing to bring along if you have those. And anyway, it's 10 o'clock, and hopefully there's a lot of skaters.
Okay, good. Thanks. And on July 8th, there's the Boiling Springs Photo Walk, which is going to be hosted by Mary and Eve. Mary, you want to give us an update on that?
That's going to be like around Boiling Springs and Children's Lake, and it's also going to be some of the side streets this time. So that should give a whole different appeal to people, hopefully.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot. Coming later in July, of July 12th, there's going to be the State Capitol waterfall. And Eve, you're leading that one.
Yes. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, okay. I can.
Right. Yeah, we've done that before. It's a nice opportunity. Summertime, the colors they usually have at the fountain, they change the colors and such. I'm not sure. Do you have the time that we're meeting?
I think it says 8 p.m.
Yeah, okay. All right. I wasn't sure. I'd have to look that up. But anyways, it's tripod is necessary. You get the blue hour, you get it after the sun goes down. And every picture is a little different because the waterfall is, or the fountain is obviously moving the whole time. So mm-hmm. it's a great shoot.
Yeah, I've seen some of the pictures from the past ones, and it's been impressive. Okay, I got two others here. One is July 22nd. We're doing a photo walk at Messiah University. There will be Joe, Dennis, Elaine, and myself kind of leading small groups. Same thing we did last year. And that worked out pretty well last year. Another thing that we're there that's being worked on, but we don't have a date yet, is we're looking into doing a studio lighting workshop at the Fine Art Photo in Lemoyne. And as soon as Joe has more information on that, we'll get that out to everybody. All right. Anybody else have anything they want to mention? Hearing nothing? You know, the more you talk, the less time Mike has.
Maybe I better start thinking of something.
Okay, so it's now time for our keynote speaker. Tonight's presentation is Funkography, with Mike Donovan. He has asked that rather than asking questions during the presentation, please enter them as in the chats, and he will answer them after he finishes his presentation. Okay? Over to you, Mike.
All right, let's try the share screen.
If it works.
Oop. Okay, share sound.
Got it.
Okay. Should be full screen, and can you hear me?
Yes, yeah. And yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
All right, it shows the term funkotography. Because that doesn't.
Before we go any further, I'm going to mute everybody and then have you unmute yourself.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
Everybody should be muted now, but they're not.
All right. Hold on.
You're good. Don't worry about it.
Okay. Mark, I don't hear anything, so I don't hear you.
Oh, how about now?
Now I hear you. Can you hear me?
I can hear you just fine.
Okay. Should we start again?
Yep, go ahead.
Okay. All right. I chose the word funkotography because it doesn't really exist. And I thought it might be kind of fun to look at some funky things that you can do with your photography to, I don't know, get things going a little bit. If you're tired of something, maybe this will help you to try something new. So let's take a look at some different styles, different techniques, and so on. And we'll even, you know, get a little funky too. Mark, can you hear it?
I sure can. Slide the family stone.
Okay. You can take a look at my funky friend here. Take a close look. And you can do funky things just with your processing. My buddy's head is on the Lincoln statue and Lincoln's head is on my buddy. So you can just do any kind of fun stuff that you want to. But let's take a look at some different things you can do to maybe pep things up a little bit.
Today I'm going to show you how to turn your Canon DSLR into a digital pinhole camera. You'll be surprised to hear that with pinhole photography, you don't need a lens. You simply shoot the picture through a hole. It's cheap, low-tech, but lets you create amazingly artistic blurred images of static subjects such as our still life here. To get started, you'll need a spare body cap for your camera, a piece of thin metal, a small square piece cut from an aluminium drinks can is ideal, a pin or needle, some scissors, tape, fine sandpaper and a drill. First, pop your body cap on a block of wood to protect the surface you're working on and drill a hole in the centre of the cap. This needs to be about 5mm wide. Make sure you file away any loose bits of plastic so they don't fall off inside the camera body. Use a pin or a needle to make a hole in the centre of the metal square and then use the fine sandpaper to file down the hole so it's nice and smooth. Now tape it to the inside of the body cap, making sure you line the pinhole centrally with the hole in the cap. To make the preparation simpler and for the best results, you can use a pre-made laser drilled pinhole, which are readily available online. Now it's simply a case of attaching the body cap to your camera and taking some pictures. There are, however, a few tips you need to know to get the best results. A tripod is essential as a pinhole has a very small aperture, which means exposure times are likely to be long, typically several seconds, if not minutes. Also, you'll have to guess the shutter speed as your camera's exposure meter won't be able to calculate a good exposure through the pinhole. So switch your DSLR to manual mode and start off with settings for about 5 seconds at ISO 200. A spot of guesswork is needed for the composition at first, so take some test shots and refine the settings until you get a good looking exposure and composition. As we're shooting a still life indoors, we're going to use some off-camera flash to add a bit of depth and vibrance. Simply switch the flash to manual mode at a quarter power and point it towards the subject, making sure it's not in the shot. Then flash multiple times during the exposure using the test button from slightly different angles depending on the effect you want. For our setup, three flashes at a quarter power with a shutter speed of 8 seconds worked out perfectly. So why don't you put your DIY skills to the test and make your own pinhole camera?
Now, these photographs were done with the pinhole. One or two were made with the pinhole body cap, like she showed, or you can actually purchase pinhole cameras. You can get them made out of, you can get them made out of paint cans. You can get them made out of, I remember doing a pinhole session before, and one guy turned his panel truck into a pinhole camera. So you can really use about anything. And if you remember, she said that a couple seconds is usually exposure. That's why the water looks so creamy and the sky looks so like you can almost see the movement because of the long exposures. And really, you can do anything with the pinhole. Now this, a friend of mine inherited a house from her mother, and it turned out that it was a log building, and she tore all the walls off the inside so that the logs would show, and wanted a pinhole done of one of the corners. Well, the exposure was 45 minutes. So I told her, we'll just have to do one or two a night. But you see, the pinhole has a kind of an old low-tech look to it. You also get some surprises with the pinhole. The light beams up in the top right. I didn't even see. I didn't even know they were there. And the pinhole, these, a lot of them are film shots. But the pinhole that she showed on the video, you can make that, put it on your own camera. This one's processed, actually. So once you get the pinhole, you can do whatever you want. They do lean toward an older kind of thing. This is how it looked right out of the camera. No processing, no nothing. There's no, the pinhole camera I use has no viewfinder, no light meter, no nothing. The shutter is a little stick that you move in front of the pinhole and then back up. But you see the feeling that they have and the feeling that you get from them. Here's a good shot of the sky moving. You can tell it's a long exposure. So one of the things you can do is make a pinhole, take the lens off, put the pinhole on your camera, and have some fun. Here's something called a Buddha board.
our everyday lives becoming busier and busier, we all are looking for ways to escape. The Buddha board allows you to step away from your daily routine and focus on yourself and your thoughts. It's based on the Zen concept of living in the moment. Using water to paint on the board, your creation will come to life. Then, as the water slowly evaporates, your work will fade away. The board is perfect for exploring ideas and designs because it can be used over and over again. Buddhism encourages you to be mindful of your thoughts, actions, and feelings. As the water disappears from the board, whatever feelings and emotions went into your work will dissolve, leaving you with a clean slate, but also a clear mind.
I designed Buddha board based on two main elements. The first is based on the Zen concept of living in the moment. It also teaches impermanence and change. The other element of it is just all about having fun and doodling and trying different techniques and really tapping into the creative side that I know we all have in us.
The Buddha board comes with a calligraphy brush, but you can apply water in almost any way you can imagine. And it's fun for all ages. The board is perfect for doodling, practicing calligraphy, or making something artistic. But your work will fade away, so if you create something you really love, be sure to take a picture of it.
So the Buddha board, what you touch, where you touch it with water turns black, so it looks like ink, actually. So I decided to photograph the Buddha board, and I threw water on it. I squirted with a squirt gun. I'd spin it around. I'd take a wet cloth and whip it at it and all kinds of things. And what I wanted to do was try to relate the shapes and the colors to an emotion. It was a show, for lack of a better word, called Abstract Emotions. So this one was heavy on the processing. Now, this is the raw material right here, the water on the Buddha board. That's all that is. And then photograph. So my first step was to reverse it or invert it so that the Buddha board was black and the water part was white. And from there, I went on to try and express emotions with it. So you'll see the emotion that I'm trying to show up in the top left. And all the rest of it is processing. So you can have a ball processing these things. Now, I have an aunt who is 90, and she went to see this show. It was hanging at the New Cumberland Public Library. And I had a book for comments, and her comment was, "Oh my." And that's it. This is what it looks like when it's inverted, when the board is black and the water is white. So you just start with the water splashed on the Buddha board and take a picture of it and go crazy. I'm not sure about all the Zen part, but they are fun to splash. So you might remember that one from the beginning when it was just water on the Buddha board. That's what it ended up to look like. So you can have some fun with the Buddha board. You can make things look as funky as you want or as pleasant as you want. It depends on the colors you use, the shapes you end up with. So if you decide not to make the little pinhole thing, you want to try the Buddha board, they're, I don't know, like $30, maybe something like that. And they're fun just to splash around with. Now the camera obscura, I have a note here, it's not cheating. There's a bit of a controversy over a lot of Vermeer paintings and the girl with the pearl earring and so on, that a camera obscura was used. Well, maybe it was. You can actually make your own.
built a cardboard camera obscura. This camera obscura is an educational toy that demonstrates the optics of the human eye and photographic cameras. You can build it using materials and tools that you might already have at home. While building the camera, you develop engineering and craftsmanship skills. The camera has two parts. This front part is an open-ended box with a magnifying lens mounted on the end. The rear part is another open box with a sheet of tracing paper covering one end. It fits into the front part. You move it forward and backward to focus the image on the paper. You view the image from behind the paper. This is what it looks like, a live upside-down movie projector. As you can see, you need to adjust the lens to paper distance as you change between close by and distant scenes. The camera does not by itself record the image. You can optionally add these f-stops for control over the sharpness and brightness of the image. The companion website gives complete step-by-step instructions for building this camera, including detailed plans that you can print out. It also presents some alternative designs, like this one, which uses a mirror to invert the image so you can see it right side up. Go to the website to see all this and more.
Here's the camera obscura that I use. It's made of wood, and you can see the magnifying lens is in a brass tube in the front, and you focus it by twisting the brass tube and pulling it out a little bit or back in a little bit. Inside the cube is a mirror resting at a 45 degree angle, and the top, there is no top, it's the ground glass that you see. So the image comes through the lens in the front, hits the mirror, the 45 degree mirror, and then appears on the ground glass on top. Then you photograph what is on the ground glass. Now, if you're doing that really indoors or outdoors, you need to have a cover over your head and all that kind of thing so that you look like, you know what you're doing. And plus so that you can see the image much better. So here are some images done with the camera obscura. And the one that they showed that you can make out of the cardboard, you would photograph into it for what's on the paper, on the frosted paper. That's what you would photograph. And they'll look, hopefully, something like this. That's what appeared on the top of the camera obscura that I have. Now you can see, you can get the focus pretty good actually. That one obviously was done outside, so I had to have the cover over my head, and you have to put it on a tripod. At least I do, because otherwise it's wiggling all around. And you could also put a Fresnel lens on top. You could put clear glass on top. You could put tracing paper on top, whatever you wanted. And I think really it lends itself to still life. Now this one was done outside. It hasn't been processed at all. This is how it came out of the camera. And that is a photograph of the top of the camera obscura. And not just still life, but old things, I think, look really good with the camera obscura. And if you would make the cardboard one, the look would kind of be the same. It might not be as sharp and clean, but it would be pretty much the same, I think. There's another one outdoors that hasn't been processed. So the camera obscura, you could make one, you could order one. Now the one I have really wasn't cheap. It's made of walnut, and it's, you know, it came off Kickstarter, so I got it at a good price when they were just starting. But you can make your own really fairly easily. I mean, you don't even have to make the box. You could just start with a cardboard box. Okay, you could also try photographing with no lens at all. You could take off your lens, and you'll see why it works best with a film camera. I did this one with an old Pentax SP1000, which was my first, what I considered to be a real camera. Now, some people would look at that and say, oh my gosh, it's so grainy. Oh, it's not sharp at all. Oh, look at the exposure. You can't even tell what's what. That was the fun part. You can tell they're flowers. And I printed this pretty big, and it looks kind of cool. It looks like an impressionist painting almost. Those are philodendron leaves. And that's always been one of my favorites. I just think it has a certain peacefulness to it, but that was taken with no lens. These are film, like I said, African violet with no lens. So I thought to myself, being the smart person that I am, I bet this would work great with the Fuji mirrorless camera. So I took a picture of a yellow marigold. And there it is, the yellow marigold with the Fuji mirrorless camera. So I decided to try it again with the darker marigold. There's the darker marigold somewhere. So it doesn't happen with the newer cameras. It really doesn't happen, at least not with the mirrorless anyway. The old film cameras, if you still have a film camera laying around, get yourself a roll of film, take off the lens and give it a try. The old SP1000 was totally manual, completely. The light meter was a little floating needle, and that was it. So if you want to give that a shot, photographing without a lens, go to it. Now, I took a class on a website called Domestika. There's a couple different ones that offer classes, but this kind of intrigued me. It was called a hybrid photography class, but really what it came down to is doing weird things to your photographs and seeing how it came out. This one had to do with self-portraits. Now, what I have to do here is, as quickly as possible, set up the translation, because she is Portuguese. So hopefully I'll catch it pretty quickly.
As três técnicas que eu vou te ensinar hoje vão ser café, enferrujar e a intervenção com cera de vela. Então, para começar, eu vou botar uma camada fina de café só para conseguir tonalizar e dar esse efeito mais antigo. Se eu deixasse assim, eu já conseguiria ter essas manchas que ficariam depois que o café secasse, claro. Mas nesse caso, eu vou deixar ele tonalizar toda a foto. Se vocês deixarem de um dia para o outro, o café entra bem na fibra do papel e fica realmente muito interessante. Aqui a gente vai só tonalizar mesmo. É só a gente esperar secar para conseguir esse efeito mais antigo. Eu escolhi essa imagem porque eu vou fazer aqui a cera de vela saindo do olho dela. Quando vocês forem acender a vela, as primeiras gotas vocês tiram da foto, vocês fazem em outro lugar. Por quê? Porque senão a gente não sabe ainda como controlar essa cera de vela e pode pingar em um lugar que tu não queira na imagem e daí não tem como voltar atrás. bom esperar secar umas partes para que tu possa fazer o pingo, que se ela fica sempre molhada, ela não faz o relevo. Eu gosto de colocar bastante camadas porque eu gosto desse relevo. Esse relevo que dança conforme a luz, ele me interessa bastante. Mas tem muitas formas de usar camadas, revelar umas coisas e tapar outras. Se tu quer esse efeito escorrido, tu espera secar, tira, faz de novo. Se tu queres esse efeito camada, tu vai fazendo um pingo atrás do outro no mesmo lugar, que ele vai fazendo essa camada de cera. Bom, agora a gente vai falar do enferrujado. No caso dessa imagem que eu trouxe para vocês, o que eu fiz foi colocar uma placa de metal enferrujada com água e sal. O sal ajuda a oxidar mais rápido. Bota ali para enferrujar e vai conferindo. Se gostarias de mais ferrugem, deixa mais tempo. E o que a gente vai fazer aqui, porque não temos tempo de fazer com uma placa de metal, a gente usou essa cesta que já está enferrujada. Raspamos com um estilete, mas poderia ser uma faca ou algo que tu tenha na tua casa que consiga fazer esse processo de raspagem. Colocamos num potinho e com uma pipetinha eu vou pintar agora. E claro, quanto maior for a concentração dessa ferrugem, mais grosso vai ficar esse pingo e mais pintado vai ficar também. Bom, eu já fiquei super satisfeita com esse resultado. É muito importante que a gente dê espaço para esse processo, porque enquanto eu estava fazendo aqui os pingos, os riscos, eu percebi que em volta desses riscos ficou molhado. E como a gente tem uma luz aqui no estúdio contra, esse molhado deu um brilho. E eu acho que a fotografia experimental, a fotografia híbrida, é muito sobre isso também. Sobre como tu vai utilizando técnicas, não técnicas e gestos para ir te incorporando também nessa imagem, né? Momento que secar, acabou, ela já vira outra coisa, ela se transforma. E por isso que ela está sempre viva, porque ela está sempre se transformando. E se quiserem saber mais de fotografia, do autorretrato à gestão de carreira, não percam os meus cursos aqui na Domestika.
So this is the self-portrait that I started with. I wanted to do the project that was in the class. So I tried salt and more salt. I tried one folded image on top of a flat image. There you can get a better idea. I tried ink with salt, rubbed the salt off, put the ink on. I tore a hole in it and put it on a light table. This is the one I finally ended up with. It's in an old butcher's pan, a watercolor pan. The image itself is actually underwater. And that's why the watercolor paint on it is kind of smeary and fading. But that's the image that I finally ended with as far as the class project goes. You can make a print. It doesn't have to be a self-portrait. It could be anything. And you can tear it and you can burn it and you can poke holes in it. You can do whatever you want. If you're tired of taking a picture and printing it and saying that's nice, try something else. You could always color it by hand. I don't expect you to go this fast on your first try, but you'll notice she's using a Q-tip and a cotton ball. Really, what you're doing is just putting on color. The details still will show through. She's using what's called Marshall oils. Thank you. a lot of these things work best on matte paper. A lot of the techniques that I'm showing you, this one definitely does, the painting. Now, this is an old black and white picture that I took during my first photography class at Shippensburg, probably. So I decided to see what watercolor paint looked like on it. The sky got a little funky, but that's all right. This is colored with watercolor paint. So you don't have to buy Marshall oils. They're pretty expensive. Watercolor paint will do just fine. This always was laying on the my dad's workbench, which looked like a total bomb went off on it. And in the middle of it is this beautiful white doorknob sticking up. I always was fascinated by that. And I decided to not necessarily color it carefully, but color it in the style of the rest of the tool bench. This is Marshall oils. This is not watercolors. This is my mom in grade 6. Then here's a light coating with Marshall oils. And then since I had that, I decided to try even more on another one, see if I could get her blue eyes to come out a little bit better. I needed to do more on the lips, I think, but at least gives you an idea that the detail of the photograph shows through when you're using Marshall oils or even the watercolor. That shows through as well. So if you use crayons, you can do this. Just to stay within the lines, you know. Now, the sad part about this is, as of right now, you can't get the film anymore. But I still thought I'd show it to you because you can still do what's called an emulsion lift, but you can't do the image transfers anymore. I'm hoping they bring back the film, the peel-apart film. There's a store in Brooklyn called the, believe it or not, Brooklyn Film Store. And they sometimes get film in that's hard to find. Nobody, they got a pile of the 669 peel apart Polaroid film for 20 images. Two boxes of 10 was $185. And when you do an image transfer, it doesn't always work the first time. So I had to take a pass on it, I'm afraid.
Hi. I'm Karen Reisdorf, and when my grandmother died last summer, we found boxes of images of my father that he sent home from Vietnam.
My name is Becky Lefevre, and my grandfather was an aerial photographer in World War II. He was stationed in the South Pacific. And I've always wanted to do something with his photos. This is the piece I'm working on right now. I need to make another one of these. This machine is a day lab. It's what we use to make the Polaroid transfers on. In this portion, there's a pack of film, and over here is the lens where we're gonna put our image that we wanna expose onto the film. Now, when I pull the film out of the machine, there's rollers in the machine, and they slide a chemical across the film here, and that's what makes the reaction that exposes the image. So I put the image side down, and then we take a roller and just roll it on. And the cool thing about the Polaroid transfers is that no two images really come out the same. The film is, it's got a lot of variation to it.
I'm primarily using emulsion lifts instead, which is still using the same machine, but instead of cutting it open and pulling it apart to print it onto the paper, you fully expose the film for a minute, and then I put contact paper onto the back of the image, and it soaks in 160 degree water for about 3 minutes. And then this image lifts off, so it floats in the water. You can see it kind of takes the movement of the water, so they look like pieces of fabric almost. The glass panes make it so that they're transparent. People can kind of extract their own meanings from the work, instead of there necessarily being a story, or there is a story for me, but it kind of, there's a auric sense to it, or auratic sense to these boxes, I think, you know, that sort of speak for themselves.
Now, if you're the kind of person that everything has to be just so, everything in its place, everything perfectly straight, don't do emotion lifts. It'll be a nightmare for you, because when the emotion comes off of the backing, it floats in the water like a jellyfish. I've only done, I don't know, three or four of them, and they're hard. They're really hard. These are image transfers that I scanned because, like I said, I can't get the film anymore, but this is what they look like. And you can see out around, that's where the roller squishes the chemical out. Now, she did not poke hers and put hers in water. I always put mine in water before I pulled it off the paper. And hers had some gaps in. So when you use the water, it's really a big help. Now, the reason I'm showing you this is because you can still do lifts. You can't do it with the Polaroid film anymore because they don't make it. But you can still do a lift. And I'll have a link or a place where you can go to find out all that. You can do lifts with essential oils. You can do lifts with just all kinds of stuff. There's this stuff called Mod Podge. You can do a lift with that. These are all Polaroid lifts. And they say, the story is that they were working on the peel apart film. One of the technicians peeled it apart. He didn't like what it looked like. He threw the gooey side down. It landed on the counter and printed the rest of it onto the counter. So that's really what you do. Peel it apart, throw away the picture, and use the gooey side. Okay, now this is something that you don't even need to buy anything for. If you have a flashlight, you're good to go.
Painting with light is an exciting photographic technique. Ensure you're in a dark space. Get a torch of some sort. As you'll be using long exposures, it's best to set up a tripod. Set the camera to manual mode or TV so you can have control over the shutter speed. Select a low ISO of around 100 and an aperture of f16. Manually preset the focus as you are in such low light conditions. If you're on your own, try something simple like this example. If you have help from a friend, try painting around a subject for a dynamic result. Try different shutter speeds between 10 to 30 seconds, or select bulb exposure mode so that you can use a shutter release to open and close the shutter. For this example, you will need several friends to capture a group shot. Timing is essential. For best results, wear dark clothing and know where your frame ends.
Now, these are the things that I use for painting with light. Just a little flashlight and a 90 degree PVC, for lack of a better term. You hook it onto the flashlight, and then when you light things, the camera can't see the light. Now, you might think, well, that's ridiculous. The camera has to see the light. Well, I'll show you what I do in a moment. This is the same style that you just saw. And so is this. But you can also light things with the flashlight and the tool that I showed you. You don't have to buy one. Just get a piece of cardboard and put it at a 45 and you're good. So these are all painted with light. Now, if you're wondering why in the world I would photograph celery, I did a thing at the Oyster Mill Playhouse. Their play was called the Savannah Sipping Society, and I know nothing about cocktails or anything like that. So instead, I did all the garnishes. This, of course, is the salt around the rim of the glass, but I painted them with light. I was in a dark room with a 40-second exposure, and then I used those tools that you saw to light the objects. Now, this you can do a little bit more of a spotlight like this. You can run it out around the edges. You do it any way you want, and then you take a look, and if you didn't get it, you do it again. So for this, you'll need a dark room, a small flashlight, maybe something to guard the light from showing up on your camera, a tripod, because it's like a 40-second, 50-second exposure, and then have a ball with it. You can do it with objects. That's an egg slicer, a hard-boiled egg slicer. And in fact, let me show you a whole set of something you can do. You can photograph everyday objects. I mean, they have their beauty. One thing I might suggest if you're in a bit of a rut or you're wondering what to do, and that is a project, like a painting with light project, or all the fruit in the house, or this project was everyday objects from the kitchen. So a project, and it helps you build like a kind of a cool portfolio too. If you can get 12 pictures of, let's say, fruit or food or textures or whatever, then you have something kind of cool. This is a apple corer. This is a can opener. You can see the light is just as important in something like this, or more so. That's a cheese slicer. You recognize that KitchenAid mixer. But I thought I love how smooth they are and the shapes they make. This is a an egg scale, an old antique egg scale. Put the egg on the little platform there and you'll know how much it weighs. This is the gears in a lemon ball, a melon baller. So you can do a project with anything. You don't even have to use your camera. You can use your scanner.
Welcome to this introduction to scanner photography, also known as scanography. My name is Dale Hoopingarner. Did you know that you can use your digital scanner as a camera? You can take pictures with the scanner of flowers, leaves, and other objects that produce beautiful nearly 3D effects. The high resolution that is offered by today's off-the-shelf scanners means you can expand the resulting print and make a very high resolution result, often in stunning detail. To use your scanner as a camera, totally remove the cover. Be sure to clean the glass very thoroughly because any stray dust or pollen will show up on the resulting image. Arrange your flowers or leaves or other objects face down. You're actually building up the image from the back. Run the preview of the scan and then adjust the arrangement or the settings of the scan appropriately to get the image you desire. Finally, turn off all the lights in the room. You'd like the room as dark as possible to make the black outline of the flowers. Finally, take your scan. The result can be a very high resolution file, but they can get rather large. 1200 dots per inch means a 450 megabyte file, but you can then print it at 3 to 4 times size and achieve a very high resolution 300 dots per inch image, which is about the maximum that the human eye can detect anyway. When editing, be sure to always use the TIFF format because JPEG loses some image quality every time you save the file. When editing in Photoshop, adjust your brush settings for the size you want, the sharpness or the softness of the brush, and in the opacity as well, as appropriate for the edge of the flower or leaf that you are editing. The spot healing brush can be a wonderful tool to get rid of any spare dust or pollen specks that may otherwise mar your image. Here's a view of me editing a picture. Notice how I have taken a rough outline of black around all the parts of the flowers and petals. Then I'm going to go back and edit closer with a fine brush, softer, as appropriate to get close to all the little edges. Thank you. Now sit back and enjoy some of the results that this technique can produce.
These were all done on a scanner. I mean, you can get some really nice stuff. I told you that I was working on the garnishes. I tried some on my scanner. This is a kiwi, and you can tell it's not a very fresh one. But it's kind of like setting up a still life. And you can see they have like a certain, I don't know, like almost a little bit of a faded look. But you also can tell they show every detail. They're super sharp. And you can set it to incredible dots per inch on your scanner. Now get out there and get funky, or stay in the house and get funky. It's certainly your choice. Let me show you a couple things, a couple places you can look. And if you want to get a pencil and a paper and write these down, or I'll leave them up here for a couple minutes and we'll have some funky help while you're doing that. First one, that NHTSA Creative Studio. If you want to pick any of them, I'd pick that one. She shows you how to do transfers a lot of different ways. Okay, Mark, let's check the chat and see if we have any questions, okay?
Yeah, you have a few.
All right. Maybe I can even answer one, I hope.
Well, the first one was dealt with your, the very first, the pin camera, pinhole camera.
Okay.
How would you control focus?
You don't.
See, you could answer one.
The only possible way to control focus is there. You can buy pinholes to screw onto the front or mount on the front of it.
Hey, Mike, I accidentally muted you.
Okay.
I got you back. I accidentally muted you.
Accidentally, huh?
Yeah.
the focus, the only possible way to control the focus is to walk closer or back up. The other thing that controls how sharp the picture is the size of the pinhole. If you can send away for pinholes, they're on a little tiny square of brass usually. Some are aluminum, but that the smaller and better, the cleaner the pinhole, the sharper your image will be. But that's really the only way.
Okay. Somebody had two questions here. Where can I purchase a Buddha board? And I think you had that with buddhaboard.com.
Yeah.
And they were also asking about where I can purchase a camera obscura.
Well, the camera obscura came from a company called, Camera Lucida, I think it was. I'll look that up and then give you that answer. I got it actually through Kickstarter when they first were starting. Wow. So I have the website and I'll get a hold of that. In fact, okay. I'll call it up while we're doing this.
Okay, and within 15 minutes of you talking about the Buddha board, somebody wrote, just bought a Buddha board.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome. Very cool.
The other question was, what kind of Polaroid film works with the emulsion lifts?
With the emulsion lifts, it's the 60-second. I don't know what the number is, but it's the ones that shoot out of the camera, and then you wait 60 seconds, then you cut off the white border out around it.
Ah, okay.
So it's the flat 60-second ones.
Gotcha. All right. The next question is, what background are you using to paint when you paint with light?
I have a black cloth. So okay. If you have maybe a dark blue towel or a black sheet, but that's what I'm using. I'm using a black cloth or a black sheet for the background.
Okay, great. Next question was, what kind of scanner do you have?
I have an Epson, I believe it's a 6000. It's a flatbed, of course, because mm-hmm. you have to lay the stuff down on it, but I think Epson 6000.
Okay. Okay. Those are all the questions we have in the chat. If anybody else, somebody just wrote Ilford makes camera obscura, check B&H.
Oh, good. Okay.
All right. And like I said, there's no other questions. So what I will do is if anybody's got a question, just hit your space bar, unmute yourself and ask away.
Mike, this is Terry. Yes. Have you ever used fiber optic strands, the glass strands, to do painting around, light painting around someone?
I did not.
I'll tell you what else works
is those little glow sticks.
Yes.
You can use that. That'll work.
Have you ever worked with a pixel stick?
No.
You know what it is?
It's not the one where you snap it and shake it?
No. Oh, no, no. A pixel stick is about 5 to 6 foot long. It has a built-in computer. And there's LEDs that it can do multiple colors. And then you take and create whatever picture you want to print or to paint in thin air. Put this on a card, slip it in, and then you can paint whatever you want in the air. I got it for half price, but they're very expensive.
Yeah, that's a problem with some of this stuff for sure.
Yeah.
Hey, Mike.
Yes.
Don Uvick.
Hi, Don.
Hi. It's the Polaroid Type 600 film, I think, that you're talking about. That's the cuffed kind I have from my old Polaroid still.
Okay. The 669 is the peel apart. That you can't get anymore. But the 60-second stuff is the 600 then?
Yeah, Type 600. At least that's the one I have. Now, this is an old, ancient box that I had forever. I mean, I okay. So unless they've changed the numbers, that should be it.
All right, thanks.
Uh-huh.
Mike, this is Dave Marchetto.
Hi, Dave.
Have you, great presentation. As usual. Mike, have you ever... experimented with different kinds of pinhole cameras? Is it called a sieve? And, you know, multiple pinhole lenses, you know, slashes and the like?
Yes. I have two pinholes for on the digital camera. One of them can change the f-stop. So if you remember when they showed the camera obscura, the guy slid different size holes across the front. Well, I have a pinhole attachment for my digital camera that you can twist it and the pinhole gets larger or smaller.
Mm.
Now what it does is it slides a different pinhole into place, really. But I have done that and I find that it definitely makes a difference. The smaller the pinhole, the image is definitely cleaner, you can tell.
Mike, do you have any idea what an f-stop might be? Maybe the smallest you can get from a pinhole. I mean, I know somehow you could probably calculate it.
Yeah, I have one of my pinhole cameras is f/128, so the aperture is 128, which of course makes the exposure time 3, 4, 5 seconds. Or like the one I talked about, 45 minutes.
Great presentation, Mike.
Oh, thanks. Anyone else?
Any other comments or questions?
Hey,
Mike. Go ahead, Norbert.
Hey, this is a Fuji makes a camera called Instax.
Yes.
TAX. Now, that's like a Polaroid, and I have one. I've not tried doing any kind of things with a Polaroid techniques like you're talking about, but I wonder if it would work.
You can probably do the emulsion lift.
That's what I'm wondering.
Yeah. Yeah. It does, when it comes out of your camera, does it have like a white border around it?
I believe it does.
Well, cut that off.
Yeah.
And then soak the picture with the backing, soak that in water. And then little by little, you can work it off with like a little brush or something like that. Because they're super, like they're kind of fussy, you know, it's like it is a piece of saran wrap floating around in there. The real fun is trying to get that thing onto a piece of paper.
I can imagine.
That's a nightmare. You got to put the paper underneath it, under the water, and try to slide the paper up and catch the emulsion. it's thrilling.
Yeah. Okay.
But it should work.
Yeah, I'll give it a try. All right. Thanks, Mike.
Sure.
Mike, do you know any place over in your area where maybe the club could get together and do a nighttime light painting?
Oh boy, it's hard to find a dark place, isn't it?
Yes.
Hmm.
When I was in Hershey Club, I created a whole bunch of tools. I have a tennis racket with lights on it that blink. That when you do that at night, you get all kinds of color trails.
Oh, right.
I have about four different lightsabers I made. I have one thing where you can, it's a little blue LED and you can actually write your name in the dark, like you were writing with a pen.
Yeah. I don't know. I'll have to talk to the curriculum director, I guess.
I'll bring it all over. That's a whole bunch of stuff, believe me.
All right.
It's a lot of fun. The biggest fun I had was when we took, now this one's dangerous though. When we took and put, I want to say, I don't know why I always want to say Brillo pads.
Steel wool
into a whisk. Set it on fire. That's a lot of fun. Dangerous, but it's fun.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, I did it one night. I had an old jacket and an old hat and gloves, and I got a bunch of burn marks, not on my skin, but on the coat.
Right.
Hey, Mike, Dave again. I forgot to ask you about the Lens Baby specialty lenses.
Yes.
Have you ever had a chance to use those specialty lenses? Can you speak to it?
I do not own one Lens Baby. I know that it's certainly better than rubbing Vaseline on your camera, on your lens. The best thing about Lens Babies is you can get different ones to do different things. So that's you know, there's a fog one and there's a star one and there's all that kind of thing. So no, to answer your question, I don't use a Lens Baby, but if you want to try something like a Lens Baby, you can put saran wrap over your camera lens and put a little bit of Vaseline on that. But don't forget to put the saran wrap over it.
Thanks.
But no, I have not used a Lens Baby.
Great. Any other questions? All right, then. Mike, I want to thank you for a great presentation.
You're very welcome.
I want to thank everybody for attending. Our next meeting, once again, will be July 10th. Okay, so it's going to be 3 weeks from now.
Okay.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks. Thank you, Mike.
Bye. Night.
Thanks, Mike.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thanks, great. Mike.
Thanks again, Mike.
I hope it was funky.
It was.
Very funky.
Especially the music.
Were those songs oldies to you?
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, I don't really remember them. I just heard about them. Okay, yeah, I remember them.
Okay, we're signing off now. This is getting foolish.
All right.
Bye now.
Bye.